Astronomy is a way to look at the world around us, and more importantly, the world above us through the prism of science. It's a scientific journey, and it's a way to explore the world through the fundamental laws of physics. And in astronomy, we concern ourselves with some of the most profound questions that the human mind has ever bothered to ask. For example, did our universe have a beginning? Now, if our universe had a beginning, then common sense, which sometimes works, which sometimes doesn't work, but common sense would tell us that if our universe had a beginning, it might also have an end. So, will our universe ever end? How old is the universe? How vast is the universe? How big is the universe? Okay. All the things that we see around us, all the matter that we see around us, including ourselves, what is the source of this matter? Where did we come from? The origin of things. What is the nature of time? Okay. Time, perhaps the most elusive of all the physical quantities that we know. Is there a way to come up with a physical description of what time is? And last but not least, are we the only sentient beings in this entire universe asking these super ultimate questions? Are we alone in this universe? So these are some of the questions that astronomy concerns itself with. And we know that we are not the first generation to ask these questions. Ever since humankind looked up at the night sky, ever since we started staring at the night sky, we have been scratching our heads, trying to find a purpose for our own existence. We have been trying to tell the story of the universe. And astronomy is only one version of what the universe is and the story of the universe. Now, science is not the only way, as we found throughout this TED Talk series, science is not the only way to engage with the world around us. We have art, we have music, there's literature, there's poetry, there's politics, there's economics, there's spirituality, philosophy, all different kinds of human endeavors. And in my humble opinion, each one of them is legitimate, each one of them is important, because they try to provide us with a slightly different way of looking at the world around us and our own place in it. Now, science is also important, and one can learn a great deal from science if we pay attention to what the science is telling us. And as I would try to emphasize in this presentation, no matter who we are, where we come from, what careers we might be pursuing, what roles we might be fulfilling in society, it's very important that once in a while, occasionally, we tune into science and try to understand what's happening in the world of science. And I say that we all should do this, not just because we are living in a time when science seems to have a claim on truth, but also because I strongly believe that the scientific worldview can be as enriching, as entertaining, and as liberating as great art, or great music, or spirituality. Okay, so that's the plan for the rest of the talk. What I will try to do is, I'll try to take you on a journey through the cosmos, a few minutes of astrophysics, where I'll try to touch upon some really interesting insights that we have gained about the physical universe through research in astronomy of the last 100 years. Now, one of the recurring realizations that exist in astronomy is that we are living in a very vast universe. Now, that's not news to most of us. Of course, we all know that we are living in a very vast universe, and we don't need astronomy to tell us that. But what makes astronomy important is that astronomy gives us a true sense, a true measure of how vast a universe we inhabit. So let's begin our cosmic tour, let's begin our cosmic journey. And like all great journeys, this journey should also begin from home. So let's start our journey from the place that we call our cosmic neighborhood, which is the solar system. So all the planets going around the sun, and we know that sun is just one star in the entire universe. The nearest star to the Sun is a star called Alpha Centauri and Proxima Centauri. And these two stars are at a distance of about 4 light years from us. Now, what that means is that traveling at a speed of 300,000 kilometers in 1 second, light would take 4 years to get to us from Alpha Centauri and Proxima Centauri. Okay. And Sun, Alpha Centauri, Proxima Centauri, these stars, they all belong to a vast collection of about 200 billion stars that we call the Milky Way. And all the stars that we see in the night sky, it belongs to them, our Milky Way galaxy. So suppose we could travel at a speed very close to the speed of light, which is technically, technologically currently, it's impossible to travel at such large speed. But suppose hypothetically we could, then it would take us more than 10,000 years to come out of our galaxy and get a view of our galaxy from outside as shown in this computer visualization. Okay, so that's how big our own galaxy is. Now, Milky Way is not the only galaxy in our universe. The nearest big galaxy to the Milky Way is Andromeda. Andromeda doesn't look that spectacular in the night sky. To the unaided eye, Andromeda looks like a tiny smudge of light in the sky. Even though Andromeda galaxy has more stars than the Milky Way, it's more luminous, it's more massive than the Milky Way, but it looks very tiny to the unaided eye. And the reason is because of the vast distance that separates Andromeda galaxy from us, from Milky Way. Andromeda is at a distance of 2 million light years from us. So let's pause for a moment and try and understand, try and digest that number, okay? 2 million light years. What that means is that suppose you were to go out tonight and look at Andromeda galaxy in the sky with a good pair of binoculars or a small telescope, the light that enters your tiny eye left Andromeda galaxy 2 million years ago. Which means that you are seeing how Andromeda was 2 million years back in time and not how Andromeda is right now. Okay. So when those photons, when those tiny light particles left Andromeda galaxy, you were not even born. Your parents were not even born. Humankind had not even evolved on Earth. Homo sapiens did not exist on Earth. Of all the places that those photons could have gone in this vast universe, it found you. It started off its journey from Andromeda galaxy and it traveled for 2 million years through the emptiness of space. It entered our Milky Way galaxy. From there, it found the solar system. Inside the solar system, it passed through Earth's atmosphere and through the tiny aperture of your eye. And finally, that photon gets absorbed by the retina of your eye. And there, the journey of 2 million years ends. What an amazing conclusion, climax to a long story. So this is one of the incredible things that astronomy teaches us. Okay? Astronomy tells us that the night sky is like a time machine. Every time we look up into the night sky, we are taking a trip back in time. And the further back into space we look, the further back in time we are looking. So let's continue our journey beyond Andromeda. Other than Milky Way and Andromeda, there are countless millions of galaxies in our own universe. Some of them are really big compared to the Milky Way. Some of them are very small. Some of them are luminous. Some of them are very faint. So these galaxies go on and on forever. So let's come back to the original question that we started with. How big or how vast is our universe? Now, there are many ways in which astronomy tries to answer this, and I'll share with you one such way in which we can understand how big is our universe. This is the famous Hubble Space Telescope observing the universe from a low Earth orbit about 600 kilometers above sea level for the last 25 plus years. Hubble has been observing the universe from its vantage point and providing us with some spectacular data on what the universe is like. About 5 years into launch, the astronomers who were controlling the Hubble Space Telescope, they decided to do a very interesting experiment. the cameras on board Hubble Space Telescope was asked to stare at a tiny region of the sky. So if I take a 1 rupee coin and hold it at arm's length, it'll cover a region of the sky. So astronomers asked the Hubble Space Telescopes to observe that tiny region of the sky for a very long duration. It was one of the longest exposures that Hubble Space Telescope had ever done with its camera. So it was a 10-day long exposure, and at the end of it, Hubble sent the data back to Earth, and this is what astronomers saw. It's called the Hubble Deep Field. Every single blob of light that you see in that picture is a galaxy in itself with billions of stars in it. Now, this is what Hubble saw by observing a tiny patch of the sky. Now, imagine the entire sky, how many galaxies would be there. These galaxies look very faint and very small because they are a tremendously large distance from us. But images like this Hubble Deep Field tell us, convince us that we are living in a really, really vast universe. And what is even more extraordinary is that when Hubble is looking at a field like this, sprinkled with galaxies everywhere, when Hubble is looking at a picture like this, it's only seeing about 10% of the ordinary matter made of protons and neutrons in this image. But 90% of the ordinary matter is outside of these galaxies in a very diffuse state, and it doesn't emit any light that we can detect. So this is incredible, and it's what this means is that throughout cosmic history, we have only been seeing the tip of the iceberg when we study galaxies. Most of the material is outside of galaxies in a form that we cannot see. Astronomers call it the intergalactic medium. Now, some things which you cannot readily study through observations, through telescopes, people try to study through computer simulations. So here is a computer simulation of the formation of galaxies and galaxy clusters, a computer visualization of the formation of large-scale structure in the universe. Every bright knot that you see in this visualization is a galaxy or a galaxy cluster, but you would also see these filaments and sheets extending from it. And that's where a lot of ordinary matter, atomic matter, is present. And that's the intergalactic medium. So this is a realization that has come to astronomy through research in the last 30 or 40 years. And my own work of the last 10 to 15 years has been to use some of the big ground-based telescopes and space-based facilities like the Hubble Space Telescope to understand the distribution of this cosmic web of material that we see in our universe, their physical properties, their chemical abundances, ionization, etc. And the story doesn't stop there. There is even more interesting things that astronomers have found. All the things that I talked about so far, the planets, the stars, the interstellar medium, Milky Way galaxy, Andromeda, intergalactic medium, all those things are made of atomic matter, matter that's made of protons and neutrons. And what we have learned is that this atomic matter accounts for only a tiny percentage of the total energy density of the universe, only 4 to 5%, which means that 95% of the universe is in a form that we have no idea of, but that doesn't prevent us from giving it a name. Astronomers refer to it as the dark matter and dark energy, and we know very little about what dark matter and dark energy is, except that we know that dark matter is required for the formation of large-scale structures like galaxies and galaxy clusters, and dark energy seems to be a very elusive kind of energy that permeates all of space, and it is what is causing our universe to expand. I'm sure all of you must have read somewhere that we are living in an expanding universe. So dark energy is supposed to be that elusive force that is causing our universe to expand at ever faster rate. So except for these peripheral notions of what dark matter and dark energy is, we don't know much about it. So this pie chart, rather than telling us how much we know about the universe, it's actually telling us how little we know about the universe. And for the young people in the audience, since most of you are very young, this is great news, because what it means is that We are far from writing the final chapters of our exploration of the universe. We are just beginning to understand the universe, and the future definitely looks like a fertile field of discovery. Along with trying to tell us all these interesting things about our universe, about dark matter, about dark energy, about atoms, etc., astronomy also is telling us our own place in the cosmos. Where do we fit in the vast canvas of the cosmos? This is a very famous picture. Some of you might have seen it. This is a photograph taken by the Cassini spacecraft. Cassini was a spacecraft that was sent to study the outer planet Saturn. So from the location of Saturn, Cassini took a photograph, and that's this one, of the Earth. Now, what you see in the foreground are the famous rings of Saturn. But in one corner of this image, you can see a tiny bright pixel, a small pixel that looks like a star. That's Earth seen from a distance of 1 billion kilometers from the location of Saturn. Now, this is not the furthest photograph of Earth taken. That credit goes to the famous spacecraft Voyager, which was launched in the mid-1970s by the American Space Agency. Voyager was meant to study the outer planets of the solar system. So when it crossed the outer boundaries of our solar system, when it to the fringes of our solar system, Voyager looked back and took a picture of the Earth. It's a very famous photograph. It's called the pale blue dot, and that photograph is shown here. Here you see a red band, and in the center of that red band, there is a bright pixel. And that bright pixel is Earth, as seen from a distance of 6 million kilometers, okay, from the outskirts of our solar system. So to me, this is one of the most incredible things that we have done as a species. We made a probe, we sent it out to the outer solar system, and we took a selfie of ourselves. Okay. This is a selfie that includes all of us. Everything that is familiar to us, the 7 billion people on this planet, all the living creatures, everything that is known to us, all the people who lived before us and all the people who are going to live after us, they are all in that one pixel. A mote of dust suspended in sunbeam. That's how Carl Sagan used to refer to it. So this famous astronomer, late astronomer Carl Sagan, used to often refer to astronomy as a very humbling and character-building experience. Now, I would even say that not just astronomy, but truth in general, science in general, truth in general, if we imbibe the wisdom of science, then it can be a very humbling experience. And nothing exemplifies that more than this picture of pale blue dot. And I think this is the takeaway message of my talk. That if you listen to science, if you tune into science once in a while, it can change the way we look at the world around us. So as you go through your daily life, pushed and pulled by the vagaries of life, counting your losses and gains, science tells you to stand and stare at the cosmos once in a while. And it's very important you do that, you tune into science once in a while, because the scientific worldview can change the way we understand ourselves and our place in the universe. As you count your life experiences, it's very important that you keep staring at pictures like the pale blue dot and the Hubble Deep Field, because as you go through your life gathering your experiences, sometimes there can be ups, sometimes there can be down, sometimes there can be moments of ecstasy, sometimes there can be moments of agony, but all those life experiences you should learn to put in the right perspective. You should learn to put them in the cosmic perspective. Thank you, everyone.